of all the blunders of the British Empire in its exploits in what is the present-day Kenya, what can be argued to be the greatest of all the blunders was the endeavor to recruit African warriors and men of the land into the British ranks. An African man was never going to see himself as British. He wasn't even treated half as such. The African man was a potter. If he advanced greatly, he could become a mechanic or a cook. If he broke all barriers, then he would become cannon fodder for the Germans. Africans treated the World War as a great adventure. Africans recruited into the British Empire to aid its survival would ultimately spell its doom. The warriors had been trained into soldiers. The warriors had become literate, and the warriors had seen the white man cower under the pressures of war and die. The fires of rebellion had been kindled. Field Marshal Baimungi M was born in 1924 in Mwereru, Meru district of the Kenya colony. Baimungi was drafted into the British Army right after marrying his second wife and was carted out to fight for the Empire in Burma, which was then part of India, the jewel of the Empire. Baimungi served in the army as a mechanic from 1940 to 1945. It is fair to say the man gave his youth to the Empire. On completion of the meaningless chaos that was World War II, Baimungi returned to the country like many other of his like, to return to an unchanged country. The status quo was still intact. British exploitation of the land was still very much afoot. The land still belonged to the British, and the Africans still remained as a subservient class. Baimungi employed his skills as a mechanic when he returned by working for the British as a driver for the son of the district officer of Meru back then. At this point, I feel the need to stop and illustrate the absurdity of colonialism as an institution. Baimungi was a soldier. Baimungi was gun literate. Baimungi was one of the few Africans that could start, let alone drive or mend a car back then. Baimungi had been witness to the Great World War II, and he had first-hand accounts of the murderous events in Burma. Yet the British saw no better utility for him but to drive around the spoiled son of a British district officer. Baimungi could have been of maximum use to the Empire, but since he was Kenyan, since he was African, his position was to remain that of a servant. By the 1950s, efforts against the British land-grabbing antics were beginning to be centralized. The older generation had decided to be diplomatic and used the law to regain autonomy. They formed political parties and contested for majority democracy. The younger generation chose the bullet and the edge of the machete. Just as Kadu, Kasu and Kanu carried out efforts towards independence in the halls of parliament, the Land Freedom Army sought to attain practical control of land as a natural resource. Many of these fighters were disenfranchised former soldiers of the Empire. They were driven by a burning contempt for the white people that occupied the lands they had buried their ancestors in, the white people who had continued to hold them as a subservient race. Mau Mau, as the British christened them, activities were becoming hard to ignore. In Thika, Nyeri, Murang'a and Mang'u, Kikuyu fighters led by General Dedan Kimathi were leading sustained scourges against white settlements, chiefs' camps and barracks in attempts to arm their ranks. The Mau Mau pursuit for independence was becoming hard to ignore. For African men, love of the land was bred into them from birth. Africans loved their land. They worshipped their mountains. They circumcised their boys by the rivers. African ancestors lay in their land. The issue of land was obviously a ticking time bomb. General Baimungi would have instantly noticed his position of advantage while working for the man. He had access to British gun stores. He could drive. Baimungi took the oath to join the Land Freedom Army. Between 1946 and 1950, Baimungi snuck guns to the active fighters in the forest. Baimungi established a network of supply with the fighters in the Mau Mau forest until the Brits discovered his exploits in 1950. They labeled him a terrorist immediately and began hunting him down. Baimungi moved to the forest where he joined the ranks of the Land Freedom Army in Meru. He continued supplying the LFA, by making improvised guns for the army. Some of them are still in display at the Imperial British War Museum. Due to his exploits in Mount Kenya Forest and his good merit in doing battle with the British, General Dedan Kimathi made him his deputy. In 1956, General Dedan Kimathi was shot and caught by Kikuyu men, rumored to be from his village, who were Home Guard officers. General Kimathi was tried and sentenced to death and duly hanged by the British. He was buried in Kamiti Prison, and his remains have only been recently found. Upon Kimathi's death in 1956, the colonial government assumed that the Mau Mau activity in the forest had died down. They were wrong. The base of operations had only moved to Meru, and the affairs were being conducted in a more discreet guerrilla manner. Mau Mau activity in the larger Meru area persisted until independence was gained in 1963. On the 12th of December 1963, Kenya attained its independence in an elaborate ceremony at the Tononoka grounds in Nairobi. This was a major event of Kenyan history, and Mzee Jomo Kenyatta was central to the celebrations. 6 days later, on the Thursday of 18th December 1963, Mzee Jomo Kenyatta was in Kinoru Stadium in Meru. In his accompaniment was one Mr. Jackson Angaine, who would later serve as his cabinet minister for lands, Mr. Mbiyuko Inange, a prominent politician, and Mr. Bildad Kagea, who is widely regarded as the link between the armed struggle and the political class of Africans in the struggle. Mzee Jomo Kenyatta had issued a ceasefire and had requested all Mau Mau fighters to surrender their arms, for freedom had been attained. General Baimungi and his deputy left the forest with four of their trusted lieutenants, Bureria, Mwangi, Kivaru, and Gashienja, the last of whom died recently at 107 after being extensively interviewed on the matter. The six warriors were received on the Thursday by Jackson Angaine, Mbiyuko Inange, and Bildad Kagea, who were seen in the videos inspecting their craftily homemade guns. The 18th of December 1963 was useful for propaganda, since the government of Mzee Jomo Kenyatta will get to align itself with the Mau Mau struggle personally. Baimungi and his soldiers later joined a delegation for Kenyatta's home in Gatundu on the same day, the 18th of December 1963. Baimungi was awarded by the president a Land Rover KFF 660, a personal gun the president carried with him, with six bullets in it. The president is touted to have said to him, "Man never stays empty-handed." Baimungi was also promised 10,000 acres of land in Monroe Farm, which was actually white settler land. General Baimungi and his men were then gifted seven Kenyan flags, one for the Land Rover and the other six for each soldier. They left Gatundu but opted to camp in the forest at Nkanda Yankoma, upon realization that the promise of land had not actually materialized. Their return to the forest was symbolic to the fact that their struggle for land had not actualized, a protest to the promise owed to them. 2 years later, on the 26th of January 1965, Baimungi and his soldiers were killed by government agents in the forest. Field Marshal McDonnell remains the only coherent account of the events that transpired. Before we discuss the theory of the reason they were killed, it is important to note that all remaining Mau Mau, being a stronger symbol of the struggle, would be a threat to Kenyatta's young government and his cabinet and his band of cronies. Enter one Jackson Harvester Angaine. African dictators, in a bid to retain friendly face, would appoint a powerful cabinet with rich, powerful sons of colonial chiefs as ministers to act for them, so that they would remain the agreeable patriarch. Mr. Jackson Harvester Angaine was one such public school educated leader that was chosen for this daunting task. Mr. Angaine was Kenyatta's attaché to Meru. It's important to note that Meru culture is very esoteric. The Meru have their own system of governance in the Njurincheke, and they had appeared to be a fiercely autonomous unity. The issue was land. Mr. Angaine would have helped Kenyatta keep Meru district in check, and in return, he would have been gifted the land dossier. Mr. Angaine is touted to have called himself
the king of Meru.
Before his death, Field Marshal Ngaine had requested that Baimungi return the 7 flags he had been given by Kenyatta since he was misusing them. The government agents responsible for killing Mr. Baimungi and his soldiers at Nkande and Koma were also rumored to have buried another soldier alive at Meru Cemetery. They paraded the dead bodies of Baimungi and his deputy through Meru for 3 days. The government agents reported to have killed Mr. Baimungi and his soldiers due to their refusal to hand in their arms after the ceasefire of Mr. Kenyatta. This has been proven not to be true by both photographic and video evidence of Mr. Baimungi and his soldiers handing in their arms to Mr. Ngaine, Mr. Kagia, and Mr. Kenyatta on the 18th of December 1963. General Baimungi's death was ultimately for the same reason he took up fighting with the Mau Mau: for land and power.